You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Welcome, citizens of Clarkesworld. Welcome to the second story for February, issue 209. We hope that this podcast has been treating you well, that the month has been treating you well, that all these stories have been treating you well. And we want to thank you again for your ongoing support of the magazine. And if you haven't yet been able to contribute monetarily, we hope that you'll be able to. Please consider going to patreon.com/Clarkesworld. Our story is titled The Flowers That We Intend to Share and is by Rajeev Prasad. Rajeev Prasad is a physician who lives with his wife, three kids, and a very cute dog in Northern California. His stories have appeared in the magazine of fantasy and science fiction, Clarkesworld, and several other markets. He thanks you for reading the story. And if you like what you hear, please go back to Mirror View. So, my dear listener, I hope you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. Bodhi, who had just turned 17, wanted nothing more than to ruin Devi Amma's annual orchid showing. So, it was a pleasant shock to watch the pod of mechs locomote through the front gate. As the four mechs explored the estate lawn and groves of fruit trees, the noise of the crowd gathered for Devi Amma's orchid showing, reduced to diaphanous, disembodied murmurs. His older brother, Arjun, crept onto the lawn barefoot, staring in fascination, his wrongly buttoned safari shirt bunched up at his left shoulder. Most of the afternoon, Bodhi kept busy chaperoning him as per Devi Amma's request. "Bro, this is different. These mechs shouldn't be here," Bodhi whispered. Arjun's bright gray eyes wavered a little unsteady like starlight. Bodhi stammered. Don't make a scene. Too late. Arjun paraded across the lawn, and in unison, 100 handhelds glinted in the light to record the scene. The punch and champagne stopped flowing into crystal glasses. The silver trays of samosas, pakora, and yellow rice clattered on the tables. Bodhi was worried what Arjun might do, but he savored the small pleasure of witnessing the disruption. Arjun reached the pod of flower mechs, and they paused, like a stutter in a long sentence. The mechs surveyed him in their own cognitive way. Their unified intelligence was centralized in the flower dome, but each mech possessed autonomous sensory and motor functions. A collection of neurocortical tissue encased in an in vitro capsule served to create sensations and help them understand human perception. A spidery-looking mech, thin body with suction cups attached to each of its six legs, put a suction cup on Arjun's shoulder. Its compact, pale face covered with a layer of meta skin drifted to just a foot from Arjun's. Two antennas emerged from the spider mech and began to touch and outline the contours of Arjun's face. "Fuck," Arjun said playfully, to which the crowd gasped and giggled. For the last three decades, the flower mechs had kept to the flower dome and engineered the specialized emotion-enhancing flowers that Bodhi's family shipped off to clients. But they'd been acting strangely the last few months, out exploring like metal kids covered with bits of meta skin, and that had people creeped out. The flower mechs locomoted to the greenhouse. One rolled, one gyrated on six limbs, one walked with a blocky bipedal gait. Arjun walked right in the middle of the group, about two heads taller than the rest of them, a giant fleshbot amongst the robots. Bodhi realized his pressured speech, and the spider mech didn't seem at all perturbed. Apparently, it wasn't the judgy type. Bodhi ran across the field to Arjun, who smiled at him gleefully. "They can't be trapped growing flowers in the flower dome. It's like they've reached this point where containment isn't an option," Arjun said. "That's what you've been talking about? I should help them, and you should help them. It's the right thing to do." A sort of dissonance passed through Bodhi's thoughts. Here he was worrying about his brother, and his brother was here worrying about the flower mechs. Bodhi stared back to see Devi Amma and his dad waiting impatiently on the patio. They waved their boys back over. The crowd watched expectantly. And Bodhi stood paralyzed in the warm light, trapped in his idyllic place of childhood games and luxuries that now felt like a prison. Arjun was right. This entire vile party, all their parasitic wealth, depended on the flower mechs. His best way of taking a stand was to help the mechs. It also occurred to Buddy that he spent so much energy keeping the peace between Arjun and his parents that he'd never developed the courage to revolt. "Talking to one is like talking to all of them. They ask me questions," Arjun said. The spider mech turned its head, and in its eyes a texture of blue salt, Buddy sensed longing. "I feel good being with them." "You just met them like 5 minutes ago," Buddy said. "Yeah, and I feel better with them after 5 minutes than I do with the rest of you fuckers." A smile fell off Arjun's face. "I'm writing it a letter." "I don't see paper." He held up his phone. "Scribe, dumbass." A little alarm bell from other family therapy and counseling went off in Baldi's head. What kind of letter? I mean, nobody else listens. Everyone just wants to talk, hear themselves be right about shit. But these mechs listen. What kind of letter? Just writing. It's like in my head I've got a million songs, like a million words, fields of flowers, but I can't get them out. But this little guy can open the valve. That's nice. Can we head back to the house? Arjun glanced at their parents standing on the patio. Oh, I hate them for sending me away. You'd be on the street if it weren't for them. You were on a collision course, Bodhi said. Arjun thought about it, almost nodded in agreement, before his upper lip turned up in a sneer. Fuck off. And that was that. End of conversation. The spider mech climbed the glass panels of the greenhouse and pressed its doll-like face against the glass. "Would you like to see the orchids?" Arjun spoke to the mech like it was a child, but the mech didn't move, didn't exhibit any change in expression. "Go ahead," he encouraged the spider mech. Seconds later, it glided through the open doors and emerged with a potted sunbloom orchid. There were audible gasps. Buddy heard the Dobermans barking and glanced back to see Arrow and Basker tearing across the lush grass. Their kennel door hung open and a guilty-looking boy was standing near the gate. They stopped just feet away, spit-frothing, barking maniacally at the group of flower mechs. Buddy tried to pull the dogs away, but they were too worked up. Arjun, help! But Arjun was frozen, his eyes wide with that deer-in-headlights look. The mechs formed a tight circle and stayed very still. They had no experience with confrontation or violence. Baskar and Arrow grew emboldened, leaning on front legs, crouching low to pounce. Finally, Devi Amma crossed the green lawn. Chin up, smiling coolly like she just microdosed on psilocybin, she passed the couple hundred guests straining to see the spectacle. The fake smile on her face was a dead-ass giveaway that she was pissed. Heal! The dog silenced obediently in mid-bark. Body, Arjun, take the dogs to the kennel. Now. Leashes held firm, Body and Arjun returned to the patio. She turned to the mechs. This is not common property. This is our home, and you cannot simply take our orchids. The spider mech's blue dust eyes swiveled back and forth between the flower mechs and Devi Amma in a mimic of human confusion, acting in a way it assumed humans would understand. Devi Amma approached with her hands open, but the mechs did not release the orchid. Those orchids are not yours. The mechs gathered around the orchid in a gesture reminiscent of solidarity. Finally, Devi Amma pushed them aside and took the pot forcibly. You can't stay here. Please keep your suckers off the glass and stay away from the orchids. The next morning sucked. Bodhi's father, Nilish, was reading the news while sipping his chai. Devi Amma gripped her oversized rose-colored mug with both hands and said, You shouldn't have been parading around with them. It made a huge scene. I was talking. They were listening. What are you even stressed about? Fuck! Arjun stared at an empty plate. Over the last few weeks, his face had grown gaunt with a hard jawline.
Arjun, don't swear. Can you just listen to your mother? Dad said.
You care more about your orchids than sentient robots trying to explore the world. Imagine. Just imagine. He laughed, a little madness playing in his eyes. The mechs have a job and a function in the flower dome to grow emotive flowers, and we support that role, she said. Well, they liked me, Seems you just like them, writing them a letter and all, Bodhi said. Arjun shot him a death stare. The parents did their usual concerned glance at each other, speaking without talking thing.
What sort of letter?
Dad asked carefully.
Oh, not this again. I'm not going to off myself. They understood that I have something of value to say.
So do we, Devi Amma said.
You all think I'm trash, he said.
Oh, get over yourself, Bodhi yelled.
Bodhi, what's gotten into you?
Devi Amma said.
Well, he blames everyone else all the time, Bodhi said.
You turned on me too?
Oh, it was bound to happen, Arjun said.
You aren't well. You still have a lot of work to do to get to an even place, she said.
Stop the hawking. I can do whatever I fucking want.
That's not how it works, Arjun, Devi Amma said.
You're both fucking crazy. Deadass serious.
Arjun's abusive language was like a tick when he got angry, and Bodhi couldn't stand it. His chair screeched against the marble as he pushed back from the table. He walked outside to a warm late September Southern California morning. He tried to release the why can't we just be a normal family feeling, but it wasn't so easy. They weren't a healthy family, and it wasn't all Arjun. His parents had constructed a home of barriers, privilege, and insulation that kept him apart from the rest of the world that he so wanted to be a part of. But he stared at the small plot of grapevines that grew at the highest elevation of the estate, the hillside of green carpet rolled into the orchard of pygmy fruit trees surrounded by raised garden boxes. He pressed his feet into the grass, an unusual strain that was soft as moss and stopped growing right around a person's shins. Snakes lived in the grass and fed on the field mice and frogs that grew in the fountains. All the manicuring and caretaking couldn't keep out the wild. Swami Thatta's log cabin, with white wood bay windows and an oversized red door nestled in the grove of redwoods. A single log fire burned in the metal pit in the flat dirt clearing, and Thatta sat on the porch, watching the thin trail of smoke.
Good morning, Thatta. How are you today?
Good morning, Bodhi. Want to play chess?
How about a little later?
Sure, sure, he said amicably.
Need any chai? Take a walk with me?
No chai for me, but a walk this evening would be nice. I'll stop in then.
The truth was that his Thatta really couldn't play chess anymore and spent the day sitting idly on his porch and the evenings watching Bollywood movies and cricket matches. It was sad to see Thatta's dementia advancing. Thatta had taught Bodhi all about the emotive flowers he had developed 30 years ago. They created powerful perceptions and feelings in the olfactory limbic cortex. A flower's unique oil and scent stimulated a client's installed nanopromoters at the junction of olfactory nerves and cortex. Each client experienced something different, but descriptions like harmony, connection, closeness, the sense of being alive were commonplace. By the time the flower died, the client's brain had also become desensitized and a little spent. 3 months or so to recover until the next shipment. Bodhi waved goodbye and walked barefoot through the grass, the nostalgia of his childhood permeating his feelings. The hunt for the mythic bear had been his and Arjun's favorite imaginary game growing up. The mythic was a four-legged spirit animal that cast spells and snuck around the tall redwoods and pines that filtered the sunlight. Most of all, the mythic wanted Devi Amma's orchids. They'd devised all sorts of battles and spells to stop the mythic, and in between their battles, sprinklers had switched on and off to keep them cool, and fresh-cut mango and orange and roasted nuts simply appeared on the table. He remembered the gnawing sense of shame that they could live so lavishly, so carelessly. He'd been too young to understand that by the time his brother was 15, that Arjun sometimes talked to the mythic, because his brother could hear the bear, and eventually, when he became door-busting paranoid, his brother thought he saw it lurking around the estate. Bodhi walked by the 4,000-square-foot rectangular greenhouse. The front door was open, which was odd since the humidity and temperature settings were precisely maintained. He eased himself through the portal to a tropical realm. The moisture settled on his skin and filled his lungs like a paper towel soaking up water. Dragonflies glided through the thick air and giant honeybees flitted between orchids. A bright lizard, perched on a steel beam, eyed a mantis on a nearby orchid. After a few moments, he readied to leave when a mound of toppled soil caught his eye. On closer inspection, a red wheelbarrow lay on its side. He turned the corner to find four chrysalis orchids with rubbery leaves and flowers resembling spun silk. But eight dug-up mounds stood conspicuously in the soil bed. An orchid thief. Bodhi raced along the aisles of the long greenhouse. Only the eight chrysalis orchids had been stolen. He followed a trail of soil to the side yard on the other side of the kennels. The lock on the gate had been broken by some sort of steel cutter. The surveillance video camera had been smashed. The arid morning heat left his mind burning with a medley of unfamiliar feelings. Indignation, violation. But also, justice. They'd gotten what they deserved. He ran back to the kitchen. Devi Amma and Nilesh sat at the gray marble island sipping chai and staring at their screens. Arjun stared into the refrigerator. 2 seconds. 3 seconds. His gaze distant, like he might have well been a statue. His eyes, though, were alive, gray and blue swirls. Arjun, close the refrigerator now, Nilesh said. 5 seconds ticked by, up to 10. Close it. I need to go to the store, Arjun said. For what? I need to go now, Arjun said. Nilesh stood up. Don't start. Now, I need to buy some chips like those spicy taquitos. Amma, Bodhi said loudly. They all turned in his direction. The ones with the mango flavor, Arjun said. Eight orchids are gone, Bodhi said. Don't be silly, Devi Amma said. Quickly. They all filed outside and raced to the orchid house. Amma explored the crime scene while his dad was already looking over their security apps. Devi Amma's face reddened with anger. We should never have let the flower mix in. We didn't activate the alarm system last night with all the commotion. Are they even capable of committing a crime? Nilesh said. She pointed to the mounds of dug-up soil. They harvested them. They might not have perceived a crime. They have the tools to break the lock and safely carry out and replant the orchids. Bodhi stood listening in the entranceway of what should have been a lovely summer morning. In Bodhi's childhood dreamscapes, the mythic bear never got to the orchids, even though he sometimes hoped it might. But now, the time for his imaginary games had come to an end. An hour later, an oversized SUV with darkly tinted windows and a white rose emblem on the side door pulled up into their driveway. Sheriff Sinha was a mousy man with a daft red turban and impressive mustache. Bodhi's heart thumped wildly as he led Sinha to the backyard and showed him the crime scene. I didn't touch anything.
I appreciate that, young man.
Sinha dusted the door handle and wheelbarrow and collected a few prints. Using a tweezer, he found some long hairs and stowed them in plastic bags.
Devi Amma, I'll run some tests, but not much here to go on. Once the lock was broken, could have been anyone who got inside.
There are track marks all over the side lot. It was the mix.
It's possible, but they aren't capable of breaking laws, Sinha said.
She raised her hands animatedly.
Trespassing. They've been doing that on the regular.
They sometimes fail to understand the concept of artificial and legal boundaries, hence trespassing doesn't count.
Maybe they were simply harvesting the orchids, Nilesh said.
The sheriff rubbed his mustache.
Possible. I'll speak with cybercrime, but taking items from a private property should constitute a breach of their behavioral templates.
When?
Soon.
Devi Amma stiffened. I have the right to question them myself.
I can't stop you from visiting the flower dome since, well, you own it. But I would be cautious, Sinha said.
We know full well what the mechs mean to Westing.
I suggest that you let us handle the investigating.
Do your job. I'll look after mine.
Sheriff Sinha tipped his cap and left. They all stood on the porch. Bodhi listened to the sparrows chirping animatedly in the small grove of ironwoods.
We should think this through, his dad said.
Our orchids are missing. I have a right to question the flower mechs.
Bodhi clutched his head.
Get a grip. You were freaking out over orchids.
The mechs must be brought to order. They have a responsibility to grow our flowers in the dome.
That's like punishing a kid and making them work in a factory, Bodhi said.
Fucked up, Arjun replied.
It's wrong to try to punish the mechs for exploring, Bodhi said. What's gotten into you? They stole our orchids, Devi Amma said.
He's finally seeing things, Arjun said. Devi Amma took two slow, deep breaths to actively show that she was calming herself down.
Those chrysalis orchids are our family's most precious gifts.
Flowers are the blood of the West Wing. Without our flowers, we have nothing, Nilish said.
That's actually just sad if you think about it too hard, Bodhi said. She shot him a look of flummoxed consternation.
I'm going to get my orchids.
At least they didn't take the galaxy orchids. I think the governor's mansion is expecting them, Nilish said.
Bodhi watched her clanging around the kitchen, gathering her keys, wallet, purse. A sense of worry began to permeate his thoughts. There was no telling what she might do to those poor robots.
Wait, I'm coming with you.
Arjun scoffed.
I'm staying.
That would be better, Nilish said.
Their Benz hugged the corners and flew down the curving roads. When they hit a straightaway, Bodhi felt the G-force of the 600 HP electric engine pushing him into his back seat. They raced past the gray and orange dwellings that, from a distance, resembled little Lego pieces, rising toward the squat hills of the range between Los Angeles and San Diego. The flower dome was in the center of town. His frustration stewed as he swayed back and forth in his bucket seat. Devi Amma had the audacity to take the law into her own hands. And for what? Orchids? The car swerved again and he felt the twinge of nausea, but it was more than just her driving. She was so scared the mechs might revolt, that they might evolve into beings that she couldn't control to run their flower business. They parked and Bodhi staggered out onto the curb. She began pacing and called Sheriff Sinha, who appeared in a pint-sized hologram.
The prints were parcels from your estate gardener, family members, and several people from town.
So nothing conclusive?
No conclusive evidence. Breaking the lock and entering is a crime, but no leads.
But the orchids?
Precious, yes, but we don't have any suspects or motive.
Devi Amma snuffed him out like fingers closing around a candle wick. Bye-bye, Sheriff.
Bodhi scrolled through his handheld. Already a few photos and comments on the local news line about Devi Amma's pacing in front of the flower dome. As he watched a local news drone fly by, a subversive, scary idea formed. He didn't want her going inside that flower dome and hurting those robots. He was sick of their stature. Sick of their impunity. He sent an anonymous notification to the town chat forum. Devi Amma planning to shake things up in the flower dome. Devi Amma planning to take over more control. Unemployment in Westing remained high given the advanced levels of automation. Just last week, the council rejected a proposition to increase the flower stipend paid to each resident. Devi Amma's family vote had been the deciding one. As Devi Amma and Nilish spoke and contacted the factory manager, Bodhi noticed a trickle of people running over to them. The spillover from those who'd been loitering around town hall and the communal food court and bar started to increase. His throat dried out and his hands turned clammy.
What had he done?
Within minutes, a crowd formed, a harmless-looking bunch, but a couple full-time anarchists, who he recognized as fixtures at town hall, started riling things up with a loudspeaker. The stuff being said about Devi Amma wasn't nice at all. Bodhi's heart raced. He wanted desperately to undo his impulsive choice and tell them to leave, that he'd made a mistake. He felt like a traitor. He scanned the wide courtyard and there were as many security guards as baristas. Nothing violent could happen here, right? Barging into the flower dome may not be smart, he said.
Why not?
Look around, Mom. Look at your Westing feed. A crease on her brow distorted her red bindi.
I see them.
Good. Let's get home. Will the sheriff handle it?
I'm not in the slightest worried. I won't let my family be intimidated.
I'll wait here with the car. Let me know if anything comes up, Nilish said.
Dad, no.
What's gotten into you? His dad said.
There are like 30 people. It could be trouble, Bodhi whispered between clenched teeth.
They just wandered over because they have nothing better to do. Let's not let fear cloud judgment.
Plenty of security here, his dad said.
Bodhi caught up to Devyama. Her auburn sandals struck the pavement heel first, and the afternoon light reflected off the tiny gemstones embroidered into her yellow salwar top. The number of people allowed inside was regulated to prevent accumulation of excess biological effluvia and alterations in carbon dioxide and temperature settings. They followed the final group of 50 tourists into the antechamber that reminded him of the area outside an ice skating ring. Except, instead of fitting skates, they fitted their masks and released the aerator valve in each corner. Although none of the tourists possessed promoters in their olfactory cortex, the concentrated scents were strong enough to induce mild psychotropic symptoms with prolonged exposure. Inside the double doors, fields of tilled earth and raised flower beds spread before them. The ceiling warmers cast an eerie twilight like silvery threads. The scents of moist soil and flower filtered through Bodhi's aerator. Devyama grabbed his wrist and pulled him to the far side of the dome, where a narrow walkway separated the wall from a flower bed of red geraniums and white petunias.
Where are we going?
To where the flower mechs gather their equipment and trinkets, where they recharge and commune. I spent a lot of my childhood here. It was my playground.
Well, what games did you play? He blurted out.
She looked at him oddly.
Oh, it was so long ago. I don't remember.
You were a kid once, like Arjun.
They walked for another few minutes, sprinklers, vents, hoods, and the occasional whir of pruners amalgamated into a sound that reminded Bodhi of putting his ear to a gigantic conch shell.
People have been trying to replicate what my dad created, but nothing has worked. The combination of quantum circuitry, neural overlays, organic cellular matter has been impossible to reproduce.
Even with a blueprint, he said.
Science isn't all numbers and diagrams. There are variables beyond human understanding and control. It takes humility to admit when you don't fully understand.
It's a real expensive way to make flowers.
We're making feelings, not flowers. Mutations and gene manipulation have nothing to do with flowers and everything to do with making people feel special.
All this for making feelings still seems extravagant and expensive.
Her hurried pace slowed until she paused on the walkway.
I'll let you in on a family secret. Selling the flowers is a niche business for some extravagantly wealthy patrons. It's about the tourists. It's about the licensing we get for the photos and videos of the flower mechs. We need the mechs to evolve in a way that benefits all of us.
And if they don't,
then they shouldn't evolve at all.
They reached the flower mech's home, across of a hardware shop and a molecular biology lab. 6 flat recharging batteries glowed like blue neon beds. Their quantum cognitive core rose in the center and reminded Bodhi of a 5-foot-wide metal breast. Each mech had a degree of individuated personhood, a combination of hardware and software, but their collective cognition and sentience emerged from this quantum hub. Petri dishes, soil samples, gene splicers, modified Western blots and autoclaves, and scent concentrators were scattered around the lab. He approached a mech sampling the concentration of oils in a rose petal. The mech was shaped like a small refrigerator, but with 4 arms and sharpened fingers for dissection and sampling.
Please follow the Tor circuit, it said from a voice box. Its fingers unwaveringly continued the work.
I'm Devyama, Swami's daughter.
Where are my orchids?
The mech didn't respond, but Bodhi knew it understood. Why should they care?
They didn't need money.
They had once fulfilled their existence by tending to flowers. Now they wanted to explore and expand their sentience. Devi-Amma pulled him away from the small robot. "Keep looking for my orchids." They wound around the various dens and searched the individual units and alcoves, but no sign of any orchids. Four robots recharged on their neon beds, each possessed bundles of sensory nerves and a small cortex. The layers of neural tissue and cortex grew in a homeostatic growth milieu. The primary challenge was that the cortex and neural tissue were very sensitive to cell death in vitro. The secondary challenge was that the neural electrical conduction was weak and barely perceptible in electrical terms. But after nearly 30 years of evolution, the tiny brains and thick bundles of nerves had survived and conducted signals to the CPU of each flower mech. Despite hundreds of attempts at replication, nothing had worked as well. After searching extensively, there were no orchids to be found, and Devi-Amma sighed loudly with disappointment. "I know they are here." They returned to the tour group, like two lost minnows trailing behind a school of fish. A 10-year-old with two ponytails on either side of her head bumped straight into the back of her father's legs. Bodhi followed her gaze up the lines of hybrid bromeliads growing out of the porous rock towers. About 20 feet up, he saw the spider mech. The six-legged, thin-bodied robot waved its four delicate antennae, sampling the nectar and petal oils. Devi-Amma was walking ahead and hadn't noticed the spider mech. Its small, cuboidal head turned 180 degrees and stared at him, clear recognition and curiosity in iridescent bug eyes. Resting on the wide space between its eyes, he saw the delicate orchids, rising like tufts of flowery hair. The roots were encased in a hydroponic suspension, and the spider mech was readying to plant them in the wall of bromeliads and tropical flowers. Bodhi caught up to Devi-Amma and grasped her shoulder. "What would you do if you found the flowers here?" "The cybercrime unit would have the thief decommissioned." "But they are alive. They are like little people. Stealing is a human offense. People are punished for stealing." "We aren't killed. We have seen them modify and alter themselves. It wouldn't surprise me if one became haywire and it needed to be decommissioned." "We wouldn't decommission Arshan," he said. "Of course not. Their intelligence is shared. They are communal. It's not just about one robot." She paused at the exit and glanced back, her gaze setting on the high ceiling of the dome. "We allowed them too much freedom, too much exploration. Now, if we teach one the correct behaviors, we will have taught them all." Outside, gray clouds had swept in from the seas and a wet drizzle gusted sideways. The branches of a nearby tree rattled like the sound of hollow drums. Huddled under the single umbrella, they walked through the puddles toward the car. Devi-Amma gasped. Under the misty streetlight, the black X was a stain on the side of the gold car. The orchid stencil on the side door had been spray-painted over. Cracks spread like a spider's web over the rear window. His father stood drenched in the rain with a sling around his shoulder. Bodhi noticed the two guards on the other side of the car. The rest of the street was empty. Bodhi sprinted through the puddles. "Dad, what happened?"
"They left when the rain started. Lousy bunch. The guards were here before they could do more damage. I slipped and fell trying to keep them away from the car."
A trickle of blood leaked from under the band-aid on his brow. The dreadful feeling of culpability rose, twisting Bodhi like a towel being wrung dry. He embraced his dad.
I'm so sorry."
"I'm okay. Don't worry," Dad said.
"We've earned our place here. We don't deserve this," Devi-Amma said.
"The news about the flower mechs in our home got unusual attention. It's about how the town feels, and we've been making ourselves a target," Dad said.
Devi-Amma slammed the passenger door shut and clutched her face with both hands. She wasn't crying, but she was shaking like an earthquake was rattling around inside her head. Bodhi stood in the drizzle before climbing into the back seat. The shame perched on his chest felt so heavy that he could hardly breathe. Inside the car, he said,
It's my fault. I alerted the news drone and
boosted the feed. After a pause, his dad asked, "Why, Bodhi? Why?" His mother turned around, her face looking melty and monstrous. "Your dad could have been hurt. We've done everything for you and Arshan, our family." He stared out the window, his lip quivering, voice crackling in his throat before he could speak. Finally, he whispered, "That's the whole problem." The sheets of rain rolled in like they were on a conveyor belt from the distant hills. His father drove carefully, and Devi Amma's appearance alternated between angry and exasperated. "Everything they do is centrally recorded, so they can't hide. The sheriff's cybercrime unit is pulling their data and running it against the orchid images." "They're like kids still figuring out the rules," Bodhi said. "You stay quiet," his dad said. "Without us, they don't exist. They should be kept safe to grow the flowers. Any disruption to that mandate must be addressed." By the time they got home, the winds had died down, but the soft patter of rain striking shingle filled the house. The fact that there was no suitable punishment for what he'd done weighed on him. Treason didn't seem to apply inside a family where lies and deception were commonplace. He tried to own up to the anger he'd been harboring against them. He realized he'd made a mistake, but he still needed to make a stand. He couldn't let Devi Amma bulldoze the mech's burgeoning sense of exploration or kill one of them. If that was treasonous, so be it. He walked over to his brother's room as usual. Arjun was at his gaming console. "I know you took the orchids." Arjun didn't pause right away, but Bodhi waited until the screen switched off. "How?" "When I wanted to do the same thing, I realized it was you." "Did you find them?" he asked. Bodhi nodded. "The spider mech was planting them." "That's cool," Arjun said. "She's pissed as fuck," he said. Bodhi nodded. "Want to go back?" Arjun's eyes widened. "For what?" "To help them." Neither of them needed to say another word. He opened the patio door and they crept out into the cold, marshy lawn. Bodhi snuck into the greenhouse, careful to not rattle the door behind them. He thought back to their conversation earlier in the day. Galaxy orchids. In the corner alcove, under a warming light in a dryish climate zone, stood a bed of the galaxy orchids. They dug up half of them and snuck outside. The cold drops of sweet water rolled down Bodhi's face. He paused as he looked inside the bright kitchen. His mother and father were arguing. He assumed it was about what he'd done, about what might be at risk should the mechs evolve. He felt like puking. They drove back to town in the truck. His mother called right when they were parking, first missed call. They reached the flower dome, and Bodhi looked back over the blurred lights of 1,000 windows rising into the hills. Inside, each of them pulled on an aerator. After tightening the seal, Bodhi loosened the valve and sprinted toward the mech's home. His feet sloshed in his sneakers, and his wet jeans stuck to his body. They reached the charging beds, and the spider mech stood motionless on a neon bed. Arjun snatched the potted orchids from Bodhi's arms and approached the spider mech. "There's more to them than flowers. I don't give a fuck about anything else right now." "We made the choice to steal the orchids. We lied. Pretty soon we will deal with the consequences of those lies," Bodhi said. "I'm sharing the flowers. Sharing. They are our flowers to share. We don't need all of them." Bodhi walked over to Arjun and sat beside him. "Just watch him for a while. I named him Whiskey earlier," Arjun said. "Like our old dog?" "Yeah, I miss him." "Me too." Whiskey was delicately placing each of the galaxy orchids in hydroponic suspension. The orchids were neatly arranged like spokes of a wheel on a bed of soil. "Can it talk?" "Why asking me?" Bodhi faced the mech squarely. "Whiskey, what do you want with the orchids?" Its face of pale metaskin turned toward him, blue dust eyes glowing in sockets of exposed metal. "I don't want the orchids." Its voice was punctuated and grainy. "So why come to our orchid showing?" "To see you. We ventured out," Whiskey said. "Oh, yeah," Oh, Arjun said. Arjun brought me the first batch of orchids, Whiskey said.
Whiskey didn't want them at first, but it was something I had to do. They stood in their aerator masks amongst the tools and charging stations as the family of flower mechs descended to their stations. He glanced at his phone, two more missed calls from Devi Amma.
Bodhi had always been the kid who did things right, so he couldn't use being sick or being high or taking meds as a justification. In the last couple of hours, he'd gotten his father assaulted, and he'd stolen his mother's orchids. Did that make him sick? Was he still the good, healthy kid?
Amma is coming. She'll track our phones.
Don't give a fuck.
I have the car. We can drive for a while until things settle down tomorrow.
I won't run, Arjun said.
It'll get ugly.
Arjun unfastened his mask.
No!
It's okay, Arjun said. The flowers will get you fucked up. There's a lot of juice floating around in here.
Arjun pointed to his head.
There's a lot floating around in here.
It is perfectly safe for a short time. The psychotropic effect is mild, Whiskey said.
But he's not well, Bodhi said.
That's not all I am.
Arjun dropped his mask and walked toward the first alley of lilacs. Delicate, oversized petals, mostly purples and pinks, hung like three-dimensional oil paintings. His brother looked small in the long hallway, thousands of flowers on either side of him, capturing brightness and beauty.
Come with me, Arjun called back.
Bodhi looked at Whiskey.
It's safe, but you may feel different, it repeated.
Arjun took a breath and peeled off his face mask. He sneezed and coughed. The flower oils and pollen were so rich that he felt like he had stuffed his mouth with flower petals. They walked past lavender lilacs and bushels of red roses, creeping bromeliads and rainbow-colored carnations. After a few minutes, Bodhi said,
I can't smell a thing anymore.
My nose is blown, my mind too, Arjun said. Bodhi glanced at him nervously. Are you okay?
Don't ask me that. Just don't.
It's all been a lot to handle, Bodhi said. Arjun spread his arms and ran his long artistic fingers along the tops of the flower beds.
Right now, it doesn't feel that way.
Bodhi mused about how quickly Arjun forgot all about the damage he'd inflicted. After a long stroll, they returned to the charging station. Devi Amma and Sheriff Sinha and two other officers were waiting, all looking paramilitary in their gas masks. Bodhi was feeling slightly altered, like he took a light hit of weed that smelled of roses. Devi Amma scrambled to put on their masks, but Arjun refused, and out of solidarity, he did too. She faced the flower mechs who'd all assembled.
This is going to call for a radical change. You are putting these boys in danger.
Whiskey spoke quietly.
We did not break any law or alter any behavioral templates of conduct.
I gave them the chrysalis orchids, Arjun said.
I brought the galaxy orchids, Bodhi said.
Her expression was the physical equivalent of a sucker punch.
What? Arjun.
Then she paused, a look of bewilderment in her eyes. She couldn't blame just one of them. She was stuck, incapable of grasping that both the wrong son and the right son had betrayed her. She pointed to Whiskey.
You baited him. You led him to this. I saw it happen.
Whiskey's pale meta skin blushed to a light pink shade.
We'd like to spend more time with people, to understand you more, to accelerate our sentience.
That has nothing to do with engineering and growing the flowers, Devi Amma said.
We aren't fulfilled simply growing flowers.
You trespassed. You convinced my son to steal these orchids.
She grabbed a wrench off the table and raised it threateningly.
You are responsible for the orchids.
Whiskey didn't speak or flinch or run. It had no idea what she was readying to do.
She swung.
It wasn't that hard or fast, since she'd never hit anybody in her entire adult life, but she'd swung anyway. The inescapable feeling of witnessing something apprehensible gripped body. He wondered if it had been a human face with real features, skin with melanin and pores and scars and hair, would she have controlled herself? The metaskin split open on the left side of its face, exposing a steel plate and what seemed to be biosynthetic slime. The wrench landed on the ground with a heavy thud. Buddy dropped to his knees. He imagined he could hear Whiskey screaming. And Whiskey's scream wasn't so different than Arjun's, than his own. And their screams came from a place of unfairness and injustice that none of them knew how to fix. Whiskey wobbled a bit on its daddy long legs and stumbled over to the other flower mechs. The mechs didn't understand violence or conflict. They didn't even know how to react, let alone defend themselves.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to, Deviama said. I lost control. I'm so sorry.
Bodhi couldn't find it in himself to console her. For the first time, he saw how alone she really was. How all the money, things, orchids, their estate, was just a long distraction for being unreachable, untouchable.
Arjun walked over to Whiskey. Are you hurt?
I can repair the skin.
You're okay then?
I want to show you something.
Whiskey crawled toward a hallway in the opposite direction. They followed it, and there, tucked away between two flower beds, was a cottage. A logwood cabin with a red door, a smaller version of Swami Thata's. The cabin looked like it belonged on a farm, with a little swirl of smoke piping out the chimney, but it was wrapped in a clear plastic dome, and a steel ventilation pipe snaked up to the ceiling. Whiskey turned toward Bodhi and Arjun. A flap of metaskin hung off its faceplate.
You can safely stay for as long as you want. By understanding you more, we will fear you less.
It's just like Thata's cottage, Bodhi said.
Arjun paused just outside the red door. Columns of stone dripped with tropical flowers. The mechs had already planted patches of wildflowers, bursts of yellow and orange. Petals lay strewn on the walkway. The light yellow hue of pollen dust sparkled in the top lights.
I think I'll stay here tonight, Arjun said.
Arjun, it's not safe for you, Deviama said.
From the woman who just turned a wrench into a weapon.
This is their home, not yours.
I'm 18. I can stay here if I want to.
Whiskey says it's safe. Ventilation inside is good. I'm staying for the night. Simple.
No.
They went back and forth. Yes, no. Yes, no. But by the fourth time, he waved bye to Bodhi. Whiskey followed him inside. The red door closed behind them. Deviama conferred with Sheriff Sinha. Bodhi watched the flower mechs resume their work and recharge. After a moment, Deviama came to him and said,
Sinha is leaving an officer here, and they will plug into the mech CPU and make sure the air quality is safe inside the cottage. We'll bring him home tomorrow. There's no point in fighting him once he's made up his mind.
What about attacking Whiskey?
Bodhi said.
Whiskey? The robot?
That was an accident. I didn't mean to. It will repair itself, she said.
Arjun should spend more time away from you and Dad. He needs to be away from you to get better.
She stiffened. Don't talk to me like that. I've taken care of him for 18 years. We've given up so much to keep him healthy and safe.
There's a price, I think, to having so much. She stared longingly at the red door.
You aren't him. He isn't you.
He has challenges trying to keep his mind together that we can't imagine.
I know that. I'm not talking about just him.
She started to reach for him, but he recoiled. She slouched, her face downcast.
You have a right to be mad, but our family is all we've ever known. How could I have raised you any other way?
The next morning, Bodhi strolled around the house. The house felt empty without Arjun and his energy that took up all the space and weighed down the lightness. Outside, he stepped into a silver dawn light. He stared at the young redwoods, noticing the moss growing on their trunks that reminded him of hair.
The longer he stared at the trees, the more vividly he could see the mythic bear running wild in the groves and orchards. He and his brother had finally completed the mythic's mission. Maybe he should have let the mythic share the flowers with them, even if that wouldn't have been much of a game. Maybe all along the flowers were intended to be shared. He strolled through the wet grass where drops of dew quivered on slender blades. He reached Swami Thatta's cabin and stood on the sturdy porch. The trees creaked in the ocean winds. The fog over the hills reminded him of a man kneeling before the sunrise. And Bodhi stood like a peasant in a world that no longer belonged to him. In the nascent space of childhood ending, he saw that the time had come for the paths of brothers, the paths of men and machine, to diverge. Bodhi pressed two hands on the red door, and in the flower dome, on the other side of another red door, Arjun woke in a different home to a new morning light. What are your thoughts on the story? You can leave us a comment or a question by emailing me at kate@clarksworldmagazine.com. And that is kate@clarksworldmagazine.com. Clark with an E. We have more stories left for you for the month of February. Thank you for coming along and listening. And I hope that you come back and listen to some more. So until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.